Hi friends, welcome to our YouTube channel Knowledge Academy. The meaning of this playlist is to discuss about the TSPSC HMWS question paper in a very detailed manner. Up to previous lecture, we have discussed about the 40 numericals. So in this lecture, we will solve the question paper of 10 more numericals. If you like the content of our channel, then please do like, share and subscribe our YouTube channel, and don't forget to press the bell icon button so whenever you upload a new video, the direct video comes to your mobile. If any improvements needed in the video lectures, then please do comment in the comment section and we will definitely include all those improvements in the coming lectures. So why to waste more time? So let's get started. So now we will solve the 41st question. See the question here. The question says about the series RLC, the RLC series circuit having R is equal to 200 ohm, L is equal to 0.1 Henry and C is equal to 10 microfarad is readily connected to a voltage source of 200 volts by closing the switch at T is equal to 0 plus instant. So here they have given the series RLC circuit with resistor value which is 200 ohms and inductor is equal to 0.1 Henry and the capacitor is equal to 10 microfarad. So at instant T is equal to 0 plus, we are going to connect a voltage source which is a DC voltage source of 200 volts to this circuit. So we need to find which is the type of the damping which is present in this circuit, whether it is overdamped circuit or whether it is undamped circuit or whether it is underdamped circuit or critical damped circuit. So out of the four options, so option D, which is critical damped, is the correct solution of this question. So let's solve this numerical. So this is a circuit which is given in the question. The resistor, inductor and the capacitor value and the source is a DC voltage source. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to convert this circuit into a lab-based domain. So the resistance value will remain the same when we are converting from time domain to the Laplace domain. But the inductance value will change from L to SL and C value will change from C to 1 by C in the Laplace domain. And this is a constant voltage, so it will divide by S. So this is the circuit in the Laplace domain. So what I am going to do is, I am going to solve this question in Laplace domain and the current is, I am assuming, which is I of S. So therefore now I am going to write a Ohm's law, which is supply voltage V by S is equal to current I of S into total impedance, which is R plus SL plus 1 by SC, because all these three are in the series fashion. So therefore now I am going to find what is the value of the I of S. After doing the simplification of this equation, basic equation, I will get VC by S square LC plus SRC plus 1. So what I am going to do is I want this coefficient value as a 1. So therefore I am going to divide by LC here. So I am going to take LC as a common term here. So after simplifying here, I will get here V by L by S square plus SR by L plus 1 by LC. So this is the basic characteristic equation. This is called as a characteristic equation. So what I am going to do is, this is a second order characteristic equation. So because there are two energy storing elements, which is inductor and capacitor, so therefore the order of the equation is also same. So here basic thing we need to remember is, in a circuit, number of storage elements is always equal to the order of the characteristic equation. So the second order standard characteristic equation is S square plus 2 zeta omega ns plus omega n square is equal to 0. So I have converted these two in the same fashion, because the coefficient of S square is 1, here also coefficient of S square is 1. So that is the reason I have made this coefficient as equal to 1, because I am taking LC as a common. So now after comparing this both terms here, omega n square is equal to 1 by LC and 2 zeta omega n is equal to R by L. So here omega n square is equal to 1 by LC, but I need omega n. Omega n is equal to 1 by root over LC. This is called as a natural frequency in terms of radians per second. And similarly 2 zeta omega n is equal to R by L. R by L after making the comparisons of the two equations, standard one and the characteristic equation which we got from the circuit. So after that, but we already know omega n is equal to 1 by root over LC. So after placing this one here, I will get zeta is equal to R by 2 root over C by L. This is the damping coefficient of a series RLC circuit. Here they are given the resistor value is equal to 200 ohm, inductance is equal to 0.1 Henry and the capacitor is 10 microfarad. So we are going to place these values in the basic formula, which is damping coefficient is equal to, which is damping ratio is equal to R by 2 into root over C by L. So I know R is equal to 200 ohm by 2, C is, which is 10 microfarad, so therefore 10 into 10 to the power of minus 6 and L is 0.1 Henry, so 0.1. So after doing the simplification, I will get zeta is equal to 1. So zeta is equal to 1 means it is a critical damped system. So if zeta lies between 0 to 1, it is called as an underdamped system. If zeta is equal to 1, which is it is called as a critical dam system. If zeta is greater than 1, it is called as a overdamped system. And if zeta is equal to 0, it is called as an undamped system. If zeta is equal to 0, it is called as an undamped system. If 0 less than zeta less than 1, it is called as an underdamped system. And if zeta is equal to 1, it is called as a critical damped system. And if zeta is greater than 1, it is called as an overdamped system. But we got here zeta is equal to 1. So therefore, this circuit is a critical damped system because the current value will not have any oscillations. It will go steady state in a very exponential manner. That is the meaning of the critical damped system. So here one more formula we need to remember. Time constant of series RLC circuit is 1 by zeta omega n. We know the value of zeta and we know the value of omega n in terms of the components, which is resistor, inductor and capacitor. So after placing these two basic formulas, here we will get 2L by R. So in any computer examinations, if it's series RLC circuit, if they are given, they will ask what is the type of damping which is present in the system, or whether they will ask what is the natural frequency which is omega n, or they will ask the time constant of this circuit. So these three basic formulas we need to remember to solve this formulas, to solve these questions. So omega n is equal to 1 by root over LC, and zeta is equal to R by 2 root over C by L, and time constant T is equal to 2L by R. So therefore, the solution of this numerical is zeta is equal to 1, which is critical damped system. Now we will solve the 42nd question. See the question here. Here they are given a match the following question, which is group 1. Here they are given the type of buses, and the group 2 is quantities to be obtained. Quantities to be obtained means quantities which you need to figure out. Here they are given a slack bus, generator bus and the load bus. They are given the options A, B, C, D. Means quantities to be obtained means quantities which you need to figure out. So therefore, out of the four options, option A, which is slack bus, the option is C, and for generator bus the option is D, and for the load bus option is B. So therefore correct option is option A. So let's solve this numerical. So this is called as a bus. So at this bus, we need, actually for this bus we need to calculate the four quantities. Means out of the four quantities, two quantities will be given. So based on the two quantities, remaining two quantities we need to figure out. So the four quantities are the power, the active power which is injected into the bus, and the reactive power which is injected into the bus, and the voltage at the particular bus, which is V bar. So it is a vector quantity. So therefore it has a magnitude and also angle. So therefore the four quantities are the injected power, active power which is P, the injected reactive power Q, and the magnitude of the voltage at the particular bus mod V, and this is the phase angle with respect to other buses which are present in the system. So therefore these are the four quantities. Out of these four quantities, two quantities will be given, and the remaining quantities and the remaining two quantities we need to figure out based on the known quantities. So here the buses are of three types, which are slack bus, generator bus and the load bus. So for the slack bus, the quantities which are specified are the quantities which is already given, which is magnitude of the voltage and the and its angle, which is phase angle, is delta. But the remaining two quantities are P and Q. So out of four quantities, two quantities are given. So therefore the remaining two quantities are P and Q, which we need to obtain or which we need to figure out. So therefore here they ask this quantities to be obtained or find. So for slack bus we need to figure out P comma Q, but they will give modulus of the voltage and the angle of the voltage. Similarly for generator bus, two quantities will be specified, which is the active power which is injected to the bus and the magnitude of the voltage, and the remaining two quantities are Q and the delta. So for the Q and the delta are the unknown quantities which you need to figure out based on these two known quantities. And similarly for the load bus, P comma Q means injected active power, injected reactive power at a particular bus is given, means which is specified, but we need to find remaining two variables, which are mod V and the delta, means what is the voltage at the particular bus. So therefore this we need to figure out. So in the question they have asked you the quantities which we need to figure out. So therefore these are the things we need to figure out for the this type of buses. But in the question, if they ask what are the quantities which is specified or given, means then we need to answer this is the option. But in the question they have asked only this one. So therefore for slack bus we need to figure out P comma Q, for generator bus we need to figure out delta and Q, and similarly for the load bus we need to figure out the magnitude of the voltage and the phase angle. So now we will solve another question, 43rd question. See the question here. The question says that the equivalent inertia constant of two non-coherent machines having inertia constants H1 and H2 respectively is. So they are given an equivalent inertia constant of two non-coherent machines, means these two machines are not going to swing at particular instant of time, means they are not in synchronism. So therefore, what is the equivalent inertia? Inertia constant they are asking for this question. So out of the four options, option B, which is H1 H2 by H1 plus H2, is the correct solution of this numerical. So let's discuss the concept behind it. So equivalent inertia constant, which is H1 H2 by H1 plus H2, this is for when the two machines which are non-coherent, means they are not swinging at the same time. So when H equivalent is equal to H1 plus H2, when these two machines are in coherent. So the derivation of this formula I will discuss later in the conceptual classes. So this is the thing we need to remember. For non-coherent machines, this is a equivalent inertia constant. For two coherent machines, means for two coherent machines, means they are swinging at the same instant of time, then the equivalent inertia is H1 plus H2. In the question, they have asked only for two non-coherent machines. So therefore, H equivalent is equal to H1 plus H2 by H1 plus H2. So now let's solve the 44th question. See the question here. The question says that pick up the correct statement from the following with respect to power system networks. So in the options, they are asking about what is the type of admittance matrix and the impedance matrix. It means what is the nature of these two matrices, admittance matrix and the impedance matrix. See option 3, which says that admittance matrix is relatively sparse whereas impedance matrix is full matrix. Means admittance matrix has a lot amount of zeros, that's why it is called as a sparse matrix. Means there are a lot of zeros which are present in the admittance matrix, but the impedance matrix is a full matrix, means there are total matrix is a full matrix, means no zeros are present. That's why it is called as a Z matrix is a full matrix, whereas admittance matrix is a sparse matrix because lot of zeros are present. So lot of zero means less memory is used to require to store the non-zero values. That's why it is easy to figure out the admittance matrix. So if you do the inverse of the admittance matrix, you will get the impedance matrix and the vice versa. So admittance matrix is a sparse matrix, means lot of zeros terms are present in the admittance matrix, but impedance matrix is a full matrix, means lot of non-zeros are present. That is why it is called a full matrix. So here for a power system, we can find the admittance matrix and the impedance matrix. So finding out the admittance matrix is very easy one. So if you want to figure out the impedance matrix, just we need to do the inverse of the matrix, or your vice versa is also same. Suppose if you figure out the impedance matrix, then do the inverse of it, then we will get the admittance matrix. So there are different procedures to calculate the admittance matrix. There are two methods for the calculation of the impedance matrix, which is by doing the inverse of the admittance or doing the some basic formulas are there. Based on that also we can figure out the matrix, means this impedance matrix we can figure out for any power system. These are the two ways we can figure. This is the first procedure, and the second procedure is the basic formulas are there. Some four formulas will be there. Based on that also we can figure out the this impedance matrix full nature, whatever the values will be present. So therefore finally admittance matrix is a sparse matrix and impedance matrix is a full matrix. So now let's solve the 45th question. See the question here. An industry has a maximum load of 120 kilowatt at 0.8 power factor lagging, consume 25,000 units per annum. The tariff is rupees 100 per kVA of maximum demand plus rupees 5 per unit. So therefore the annual saving if the power factor is raised to unity. See, whenever the power factor is raised, the amount of electricity bill will be reduced. So he is asking how much is the annual saving when compared to 0.8 power factor and when compared to unity power factor, how much amount of bill, means how much amount of rupees is saved by raising the power factor. So for this industrial loan, so out of the four options, option C, which is 3000 rupees, is the saving per annum. So let's solve this numerical. So here in this question, they are given the two power factors, for 0.8 power factor and the unity power factor. So this total is for 0.8 power factor, and this is for the total cost for one power factor. So unity power factor, this is the total amount for the 0.8 power factor, and this is the total amount which we need to pay for the unit power factor. But we need the savings. How much amount of money is saved by using the unit power factor? So therefore we need to do the difference. Then only we will get the how much amount of money which is saved. See here, they are given 25,000 units per annum. Per annum means per year 25,000 units are consumed. But each unit is a cost of 5 rupees. So therefore the total unit is to this total cost is 25,000 into 5 rupees. But here they are given a maximum demand. Maximum demand is 120 kilowatt with a power factor of 0.8. But we need the in terms of the KVA. So therefore we need to divide by power, maximum power by power factor. We will get the in terms of KVA into for this maximum demand. For this maximum demand, the cost is 100 rupees per unit. So therefore into 100. This is for the total 0.8 power factor. This is the annual bill. This is the annual bill which we need to pay to the electricity board. But here now I am replacing 0.8 power factor by unit power factor. But the amount of here 25, this is the constant one. 25,000 units into 5 rupees. But here 120 kilowatt maximum maximum demand by unit power factor. We will get in terms of the yes means KVA into 100 means per maximum KVA. This is the amount of 100 rupees per unit So therefore now if you do the difference one, we will get here 120 by 0.8 into 100 minus 120 by 1 into 100. So therefore 3000 rupees is saved by raising the power factor. So this is the solution. Let me explain again here. See, by raising the power factor, we are going to pay the less bill. So therefore, this is less power factor means more bill we need to pay. This is the unit power factor means more power factor means less bill. So therefore, we need to find the savings. So therefore, I am doing the minus to figure out the how much is the amount of money which is saved by the unit power factor. So this is the 25 total units. Means for each unit, 5 rupees is the cost. And similarly, for maximum demand, for maximum demand of unit, their cost is 100 rupees. So by this, I figure out the total cost. For here also same, for unit power factor, this is into means I am doing by division, power by power factor, act of power factor, cos phi means power factor will give the in terms of the S value, KVA. So therefore, KVA means one unit into 100 rupees. So therefore now if I solve it, I will get here the total cost which is saved is, this total money which is saved is 2000 rupees. So now let's solve the 46th question. See the question here. The power angle characteristics of a synchronous machine connected to infinite bus system is P is equal to 2 sine delta per unit. So the operating point is at delta is equal to how much corresponding to a synchronizing power coefficient of UD. So they are given for synchronous power to be unit, how much is the value of the delta for this basic equation. So out of these four options, option A, which is 60 degrees, is the correct solution of this numerical. So let's solve this question. So P is equal to 2 sine delta is the given in the question. So here they are given a synchronizing power to be unit. Synchronizing power means dP by d delta. So therefore I need to differentiate this with respect to delta. So therefore 2 into sine delta means differentiation is cos delta. They are given this value to be unity. So therefore cos theta is equal to 1 by 2 and the theta and delta is equal to 60 degree. So here they ask what is the value of the delta for synchronizing power coefficient to be unity for this basic equation. So after solving this we will get delta is equal to 60 degrees. So this is the correct solution of this question. So now let's solve the 47th question. See the question here. If a God ring is used for uniform potential distribution across a 3-unit string, the capacitance of God ring to top disk link is dash, where C is the shunt capacitance to earth. So they are given a God ring. God ring is used to maintain the voltage across each and every insulated disk. They are going to make it as an equal value. So therefore the efficiency will be increasing, means no amount of losses will be present. So therefore by using this God ring we are going to improve the string efficiency. So here they are asking what is the value of the capacitance across the first link, means at the topmost link what will be the capacitance. So therefore equal amount of distribution will be occurring. So out of the four options here they have given C is the shunt to shunt earth capacitance, means shunt earth capacitance. They are given the value C. So out of the four options, option B, which is C by 2, is the correct solution of this question. So let's solve it. So this is a transmission line. For this transmission line, we are going to connect it through a hanging tower. See, this tower has a 3 insulated disc, which is represented by capacitance. So therefore, for this link, means for this is a connector, but the insulators are discs. These are the discs, these are insulators, but this is a connector. So for connector to here, there is a some leakage capacitance, CM. So this is called as a shunt capacitance or leakage capacitance. So this is a guard ring. So the guard ring, the main aim of this guard ring is to make the voltage across, means the voltage across this will be equal, means same amount of voltage drop will be happen. So therefore, the string efficiency will be very much higher. So therefore, they are asking, from here, what will be the capacitance? What will be the capacitance so that there will be an equal amount of distribution? So let me assume this is a sum C1. So the basic formula is the Cp. Cp means this is the first capacitance. Cp is equal to P into Cm by N minus P, where N is called as the number of insulator discs are present in the string. That is the meaning of N. And P is the first one, means from upward, what is the number? This is the first one and this is the second one. This is C2. But they are asking only the first value. So therefore, P is equal to 1. So therefore, after keeping here, P is equal to 1, I will get 1 into Cm by 3. Here number of discs is 3. So 3 minus 1. So therefore, I get Cm by 2. But if they are asking C2, then P is equal to 2. So therefore, 2 into Cm by 3 minus 2. So therefore, we will get here 2 Cm. This is the for C2. This is the first C1. This is value for the C1. So therefore, here they have given in the question paper, they have given Cm is nothing but a C. So therefore, the C1 is equal to C by 2. So for this amount of capacitance, equal amount of distribution will occur. And similarly for C2 is equal to 2 times of C1. But Cm is nothing but a C. So therefore, they have given the question. So 2 Cm, 2 C. So for this amount of C1 and for this amount of C2, for these values, the equal amount of distribution of voltage will be occurring across these three insulators. So therefore, the string efficiency will be higher. So for link 1 only, means for the first part only, they asked the question. So therefore, that C1 is nothing but a C by 2 is the correct solution of this numerical. So remember this one, P into Cm by N minus P, where Cm is called as a shunt earth capacitance and P is the, from the starting onwards, we need to say from upward. If they are asking the first stage, then we need to keep your P is equal to 1. Suppose if we are having this C2, then we need to take P is equal to 2. Here N is nothing but the number of discs present in the string. So Cp is equal to PCm by N minus P. So now let's solve the 40th question. See the question here. For the given system shown in figure, which of the following is the equivalent circuit for moving some point to the left side? So they are given this block diagram. For this block diagram, we need to shift the summing point to the left side. So what will be the equivalent circuit diagram? That is they are asking in this question. So out of this options, option B, which is the correct solution. So let's solve this numerical. For this question, we need to shift the summing point to the left side. So the net circuit which we got after rearranging has to have the same output and the input. So the input is here X and the W here and the output is Y. So therefore, let me simplify here. Here input is X and G is the multiplication factor. So therefore, output is the product of the input and the multiplication. So therefore, X into G. But here output is the summation of these two inputs. So therefore, Y is equal to XG plus W. So now we need to do is, we need to take this summation point to the left side. Means here, I am going to keep here I am a summation point. So what I am going to do is, now the output has to be same thing. The output has to be same, which is Y is equal to XG plus W has to be same thing. Same output we need to get. But here, the input here also same W. But here, now we need to keep an extra block so that the output has to be same X into G. So here, I am going to keep here 1 by G. So let's check what will happen. So there, the output will be W into 1 by G. So W into 1 by G. So here input is summation of x and w by g. So the output has to be equal to summation of these two inputs into g. So therefore output is equal to summation x plus w by g into g. So if I do the simplification, x g plus w. So therefore the same output which we got in the previous case. The input is x and w and the output is this one. Similarly for this also input is x and w and the output is same. So therefore these two block diagrams are, or these two equations are, these two circuits are same. So this is the change we need to do. So let's solve the 49 question. See the question here. Here they are, the question is the steady state error of the transfer function g of s is equal to 1000 into s plus 1 by s plus 10 into s plus 50 for unit step input and unit ramp input respectively is. So they are asking what is the steady state error for two inputs, which is unit step input and unit ramp input for this open loop transfer function. So out of these four options, option C, which is 0.333 and the infinity, means for unit step input the steady state error is 0.33 and for unit ramp input the steady state error is infinity. So let's solve this question. So they are given the open loop transfer function g of s h of s is equal to 1000 into s plus 1 by s plus 10 into s plus 50. So for two types of inputs, step for unit step input and unit ramp input, what will be the steady state error for these two types of inputs we need to figure out. So let me assume the first input, the general expression, when input r of t is equal to a times of u of t, means the input is a times of u not u, u of t, then the steady state basic equation is ESS means steady state error is equal to a by 1 plus kp, where kp is called as the proportionality constant kp. So therefore kp is equal to, the basic formula is limit s tends to 0 g of s into h of s. So in place of g of s h of s we know, so therefore in place of s we need to keep it here 0. So therefore 1000 into 1 by 10 into 50 means I am replacing s by 0. So therefore I will get 1000 by 10 into 50. So if you do the simplification, I will get here 2. So therefore kp is equal to 2. But they are given unit step input. Unit step input means a is equal to 1. So therefore in place of a I keep here 1, and similarly kp is equal to 2. So therefore 1 by 1 plus 2 means 1 by 3 means 0.33 value. So therefore the steady state error is 0.33, means for this type of system, for unit step input, the error is a finite value, means some error is present. So let's solve for the another one. When the input is a ramp input, means a t into u of t, this is called as a ramp input, basic ramp input equation. For this input, the steady state error is equal to a by kv. So kv is equal to limit s tends to 0 s into g of s h of s. So therefore now what I am going to do is, for g of s h of s I am going to multiply s, and then I am going to substitute the value s tends to 0. So therefore if I do multiplication with respect to s and if I keep it 0, then the whole thing will become 0. So therefore kv is equal to 0. So therefore steady state error ess is equal to, here they are given a unit ramp input they are asking, so therefore a is equal to 1, we need to substitute. So therefore ess is equal to 1 by 0, kv is equal to 0, that's why 1 by 0 is equal to infinity. So therefore the steady state error for unit ramp input is infinity and the steady state error for unit step input is 0.33. so let me explain some more things here. This is the type 0 1 2 is the type of the system, and this is called the input, step input, ramp input and parabolic input. See here we need to figure out what is the type of the system. Type of the system is here number of poles which are present in the open loop transfer function. If p is 0 means only type 0 system. If p is 1, it is called as a type 1 system. If p is 2, it is called a type 2 system. Here in the question they are, so here this is, so therefore here, see here, for step input this is a by 1 plus kp, and for type 1 it will become 0, and for type 2 it will become 0. So this is the thing we need to easily remember. So therefore in exam we can easily, they will ask for ramp input for type 2 system, what will be the value, whether it is a 0 or finite value or it is infinity. So by this diagram also we can easily tell. So if you see in this question here, s to the power of p, here p is 0, that's why it is unity, means this is called as a type 0 system. Type 0 system, if you check here, for type 0 system, for step input there is a finite value of error, for ramp input the standardized error is inferior. So same thing we got here. For type 0 system, the steady state error for step input is finite value, and for unit ramp input, the steady state error is infinity. And similarly, if they are asking for parabolic input also, the steady state error will be infinity. So this is what we can easily refer. Means by this also we can eliminate the options very quickly and we can solve the question. So this is the 15th question of this lecture, and this is the last numerical of this lecture also. So finally we are going to solve the 15 numericals. So see the question here. The question is, an overhead transmission line has a span of x meters and the connector weighs, and the connector has a weight of 1000 kg per kilogram, sorry, per kilometer. If the ultimate strength of the connector is y kg and a factor of safety is 2, then the maximum sag in the meters is. So they have given a, the span length is also x meters and the connector weight is also, they are given 100 kg per kilometer, and the ultimate strength is y kg and the factor of safety is 2. So we need to figure out what is the maximum sag in meters. We need to figure out in this question. So out of the four options, option B, which is x square by 4y, is the correct solution of this question. So let's solve this numerical. So the basic relation between the sag weight and the length and the tension is S is equal to W L square by HT. This is called as a sag and this is called as a weight, and this is length or span, and T is called the tension. See, first we will discuss what are the units of this, all these terms, then we can easily solve the numerical. See here, this is called L. L is nothing but a span. Span means distance. Yes, the unit is meter. Meter we are going to take here. So therefore L is, the unit is meter. And similarly for T, T is nothing but a tension. Tension means the unit is kg, means kg in terms of, the unit of this tension is in terms of kg. And similarly for this W, W is nothing but a weight. Weight means weight of the line for meter or kilometer. See, let here I am taking it as a meter, means kg per meter, the unit. So now I am going to find what is the unit of this S. So we know W is nothing but a unit is kg per meter. So I have kept here kg per meter into the unit of length we already know, which is meter. So meter square by here 8 is a number, so it doesn't have any units. So therefore now T, T has a unit of kg. So kg is substituted here. So this kg will kg and get cancelled, and similarly meter square by meter. So it will, we get here meter. So finally what I am trying to say is the unit of sag is meter, the unit of W is kg per meter, and the unit of tension is kg, and the unit of length is meter. So these are the units. So with these units now we will solve the question. See here, they have given W. W is a, of this line 1000 kg per kilometer, 1000 kg per 1 kilometer. So here length is, span is x meters. This is in terms of meters they are given. See that T, T is nothing but the tension. The tension is ultimate strength by safety factor. Here they are given the ultimate strength is YKG, and the safety factor doesn't have any units. They are given this as a 2. So therefore YKG by 2, which is tension. So we know W, we know L, we know T. So just we need to substitute all this in the basic relation. So therefore S is equal to 1000 kg per kilometer. So we need to make this in terms of meter. That is what we learned here. So therefore 1 kilometer is nothing but a 1000 meter. So therefore this 1000 will get cancelled. And similarly the length is x square by 8 into tension is y by 2 kg. So this kg will get cancelled. So now this 2 into 4. So only one thing is x square is present, and here 4 is present and y is present. So the unit is meter, because here meter square by meter means meter. So therefore this is the sag. Sag is x square by 4.5 meters. So therefore the final solution is the sag, the maximum sag which is present is x square by 4y meters, is the correct solution of this question. So by this lecture we have completed the 15 numericals of TSPSC HMWS question paper in a very detailed manner. If you like the content of our channel, then please do like, share and subscribe our YouTube channel, and don't forget to press the bell icon button so whenever you upload a new video, the direct notifications comes to your mobile. If any improvements needed in the video lectures, then please do comment in the comment section. I will definitely include all those improvements in the coming lectures. If you feel any of the question, if you are not understand, then please do comment in the comment section. I will definitely reply to your comments. Thank you so much for watching this lecture. Keep smiling, take care, and bye-bye.